speaker tonight. A lot of us have been really fondly following his blog and his podcast, and it's really great to have him here. And without further ado, come on up.
Thank you all for coming out. Thanks for having me. It's amazing to get this opportunity. As I like to tell everyone that tells me they're nervous to be interviewed, I'm just a poor grad student sitting in a tiny apartment somewhere in the Midwest. So to be invited out to a wonderful place like this to talk to everyone is really great. So my name is Matt Candeias, and when Carol invited me to come out here, the idea was gardening and climate change. And I just want to preface this with, I'm a gardener in the Midwest and a little bit in the Northeast. You all know more about your flora and your conditions here than I do. I'm not an expert on anything. I just really like plants. And that love of plants manifests in this, in defense of plants. It started as a blog and as a podcast, a video series, and it's just my way of expressing my love affair with plants. But in thinking about how this all started, the funny part is I was an animal person. I thought I wanted to go into fisheries work. And that was until I went to an actual fishery and smelled it, and I decided I needed a change in my career path. But even then, I was still an animal person. I thought I was going to go into zoology or something like that and study sharks or tigers or something. But I went and worked in a place like this. This isn't the exact place I worked, but I got a job towards the end of my undergraduate career working for a mining company, which is really weird because I was always kind of a dyed-in-the-wool hippie environmentalist type. But I got hired on to make sure that they were maintaining their permitting and not polluting our water or our air too much. And this seems like a really weird place to fall in love with plants because, as you can see, this is probably one of the most destructive forms of land use humans have ever invented. What the heck is going on with plants in a bottomless pit full of rock? Well, for better or for worse, the company that I was working for wanted to make their image a little bit better. And to do that, they were trying to get some awards through some habitat restoration sort of stuff. So the traditional thing that the EPA asks all quarries to do is to restore it to previous use, which means dumping all the soil back in, putting lawn down, and selling it to a sub-developer. Or they let it flood and turn it into a really deep pond that you're not allowed to go swimming in. But this company wanted to take the next step, and that's what really attracted me to the position, because as you can see, this offers a really unique challenge to anyone that wants to try and coax habitat back out of it. And I was young and naive, and I was thinking like, oh, habitat, that just means animals. We're going to get some deer, maybe some birds, that sort of stuff. But I quickly learned that that wasn't the case. There was something else they were focusing on for one of the major restoration projects I was going to be in charge of, and it was this plant right here, the blue lupin. And if there was ever a plant that started it all for me, it's this one. I mean, for about 3 years of my life, when I shut my eyes, that's all I saw was lupin. And I hadn't actually seen an adult lupin before at that point, but I had no idea what I was getting myself into. And the reason they wanted to bring the lupin back wasn't because lupins are cool and because they're pretty, it's because of this little beauty right here, the carnivore butterfly. Raise your hand if you've heard of it. Cool. It's one of the few federally listed endangered insects that people actually know about. You know, it's not very big. It could fit on my thumbnail just fine. And it's beautiful, but it was just so strange to my mind thinking about megafauna, thinking about tigers and endangered orangutans in Borneo. And then here I am going, oh, you have to work with this little butterfly? Like, okay, that's strange. But the reason plants came into this is because we all know butterflies start out as caterpillars, and caterpillars eat plants. And I have a really soft spot for this gooey little caterpillar here. It's a cute little thing in my mind. And this is the larva, the carnivore butterfly. And the reason the lupin came into the picture is because that's the only plant this little bugger will eat. It will feed on nothing else. It won't feed on the Russell's hybrids. It won't feed on any of the lupin that are out here out west. It only feeds on the blue lupin. And so that was the first indication to me that something deeper was going on. It was my first real introduction, I guess, to ecology. This idea that organisms don't exist in a vacuum. They're cool in and of themselves. Each has its own little story to tell. But there's interactions, and those interactions matter. They matter for biodiversity. They matter for the stability of the planet. And the more I dug into this, the more I realized how cool this was. So I learned that these caterpillars, because they're so small and succulent and tasty, if you're a bird, that they're really low on the food chain. Everything wants to eat a tasty little caterpillar. So what these caterpillars do is they secrete a sugary little substance from their bum, and it recruits ants. And if you've ever jumped on an ant nest or gotten into one on accident, you realize ants are vicious little animals. And so by recruiting ants and getting them invested in the livelihood of this caterpillar, they were recruiting amazing bodyguards, because the ants will defend that food source till they die. And in doing so, they're also protecting the queen, unintentionally, of course. But if the caterpillar needs the plant and the ants are protecting the caterpillar, they're also protecting it from other things that might eat it. And sure, the caterpillar's eating some of it. They don't generally defoliate it. But this is a really cool interaction. And this, to me, set that light off. It said, okay, here's some really interesting things going on that I wasn't aware of, that's going on under the noses of most people that I know, even scientists, even people that do natural history work. I talked to a lot of people that had no idea this existed. But the real kicker was that it was only happening because there was a plant there. That plant meant something. And so the farther I dove into this, the more I realized that if I cared about animals, if I cared about biodiversity and ecosystem functioning, one of the biggest bangs for my buck would be to reorient my focus and start thinking about plants. Because, as John Eastman, great writer, if you ever get a chance to pick up one of his books, he says it perfectly. Since plants provide the ultimate power base for all of the food and energy webs and chains that hold our natural world together, they also form the hub of community structure and thus are the centers of our focus. And then, that is why I decided they were going to be the center of my focus. And I'm a nerd at heart, I am obsessive at heart, and so as soon as I get into something, I go deep. And that came at the cost of a lot of friendships early on, but I really, really got into this sort of stuff. And the more I look, the more I realize, like, you can't escape plants. If you care about nature at all, you have to care about plants at some level. And so I just went all in, and I wanted to learn more, because my body just says, you need to get as much of this in your head as possible. But I realized there's like this really utilitarian view of botany out there. Generally, plants are spoken about in terms of the way they're useful for us, which is fine. That's cool. Plants are good for medicine. Plants are very beautiful. And there's a lot of cool folklore around plants. But that wasn't going to cut it for me. I wanted to know about the biology and the ecology of those plants. And so I figured if I wasn't going to be able to find the articles and stuff myself, why not try and write them? And so In Defense of Plants was born. And throughout all of this, you know, conservation is always at the center of my heart. I just want to do my best to protect what I can for as long as I can, in hopes that, you know, the next generation gets to enjoy at least some of what I got to enjoy. But if you're in the environmental realm, if you read anything about our planet, you realize things, we're doing some damage out there, and our world is changing, and it's changing extremely fast. I don't have to preach that to you guys. You've seen it play out in the state time and time again. And that really hit me hard, because if things are going to change, and a lot of this is truly out of the control of individuals, what's going to happen to all these species that I care about? And so I really started to focus in on what could be done to think about protecting some of the plant diversity that would then protect the ecosystem diversity that I like so much. So I think really, throughout my personal life, throughout my hobbies, and throughout my own research at school, is trying to understand how plants change or respond to change. That's critical to the future. Because we are really heading into a future defined by extremes. You know, I've heard a lot of talk that the rains were really crazy this year. That's really cool, but don't think that that's always going to be the case, right? Things are going to get dry again, and we're going to experience this sort of extreme shifting. There's going to be more drought, more severe drought, longer droughts. There's going to be more storms, more intense storms. And this is what we're calling the whiplash effect, which really, especially here in Southern California, means that you're going to get a larger percent of your annual precipitation falling over narrower and narrower windows of time. And that's really interesting to think about, because to the average person, it's like, well, if we get 10 inches of rain in 2 days or 10 inches of rain in a week, what does that really matter? And thinking about the way we care for plants, we're all gardeners to some extent in this room. This is the analogy I really like to tell the people that kind of sinks into them is, imagine I was going to go away and I tasked you with taking care of my houseplants, and I said, here's a gallon of water. You have to spread this out among those plants for the week that I'm gone. Do you think it makes a difference if you spread that gallon out over the entire week? Or you spread that entire gallon onto the plants in one single day? That's this idea of extremes that's really terrifying. Is because sure, maybe the average conditions don't change, but the timing in which they happen really do change. And the more you dive into the plant literature, it's alarming because plants are sessile organisms, right? They can't get up and move around. They can't run away from disaster. They have to get up and do this stuff generationally, seed by seed, vegetative propagule by vegetative propagule. And so, again, I keep doom and glooming this in the first half. I promise I'll get cheered here a little bit, but really, few species are expected to keep up with the rate that things are changing. And if we look back in time at other examples of when life has changed this fast on this planet, we have to go back 55 million years. It's a long time. And all of the fossil evidence and whatever we can pull together from that time period tells us that when things change as fast as they're changing today, ecosystems experience massive upheaval. I mean, there was a time period when palm trees were growing in Wyoming. I don't know if you've been there lately, but I do not see any palms there today. And so plants aren't going to respond equally to this, right? Some plants are going to be more vulnerable than others to climate change. But in thinking about vulnerability, the ones that are most at risk, the ones that desperately need our help, are those with small ranges, the endemics, those ones that only occur in a few valleys. I mean, California is an amazing hotspot for biodiversity like that. Endemism is really high there. And then those small little herbaceous species, because these are plants that really lack the ability to keep up. They don't have long seed dispersal capabilities or stuff like that. And so we really have to think about how plants are going to respond and what we, collectively, we can do about that. And that's not just saying a government agency. That's not just saying botanical gardens. That's every one of us in this room has to think about this, and especially as gardeners. And that's why I think we're all situated in a really interesting position here, because our world is changing and plants are going to have to adapt in place or risk going extinct. And that's, I'm sorry, kind of doom and gloom, but I swear it's going to get better from this point on. So, our world is changing. Is there a silver lining to this? I think there is, and I think it rests in the hands of gardeners. Because as gardeners, we have a really unique relationship with the environment. We understand soil, we understand water, we understand climate, but most importantly, we understand plants. Every one of you in this room is so wonderfully situated to have extremely intimate relationships with your plants, knowing them, how they respond to different things, what they like, what they don't like. And I think that's a really big strength when it comes to thinking about what we can do for plants in a changing climate. So I think throughout this talk, there's three things I want to really drive home for you guys. I want you to think of these three things as we go forward and into the future as you continue with your gardening efforts. Respect your conditions, garden for resilience, and most importantly, shared wealth. So let's think about this. Respect your conditions. We all know that there's limits to plant growth. We've all heard this is Liebig's law or Liebig's barrel. It's this wonderful scientific term, but basically understanding the limiting things to plant growth. Those are the macronutrients, the soil conditions, the water, light, all those things plants need to thrive. They change in various amounts and what's important to different species and what isn't. But today, I think it's more important to think about soil, temperature, and water. Can't do much about your light situation unless you want to go clearing trees or something like that. That's up to you. But soil is a really good place to start, because unless you're growing a lot of epiphytes or tillandsias or something like that, most of our plants are growing in the ground. So soils, we take them for granted. I really love this quote because it's something that's really become apparent to me as I travel from place to place. I'm living in the Midwest right now, and I'm lucky to have 15 feet of some of the most rich organic topsoil underneath my feet, but not every place is that lucky. And so think about how much of our life is tied up in a few inches of topsoil in most places of the world. And we really haven't been treating it very well. You know, I sit in a lab every day with a bunch of soil scientists, and they talk about soil erosion and loss, and we're dumping so much of it into the Gulf of New Mexico, where I'm from, in the Midwest at least. So, in thinking about soil, we have to protect it. We have to do better with the way we manage it and work with it. So I think the first step is just to test your soil. Know what you're up against. Know what you're working with. I think it's really important to try not to amend as much as possible. One thing I'm really appreciating right now is the amount of life that's going on underneath the soil. There is a Serengeti underneath our feet that we don't get to see, that we never interact with, and that we only recently have had the molecular tools and the money to be able to actually understand to some extent. So the more disturbance we do, the more we're actually hurting that biota. And that's alarming because, again, We owe our lives to that layer of topsoil. Every plant owes its lives, and therefore every organism at some level needs that layer of topsoil. So I think amending as little as possible, disturbing it as little as possible, is a really good thing to keep in mind. And that's where compost comes in. I absolutely love compost. I compost like crazy. It's a really useful tool. I use it in mixes. You can do a lot with compost. And it's getting rid of another issue, food waste, right? All that waste would end up in a landfill is now going into helping you make a better garden. Also, cutting back on peat. And peat, to me, is a very useful product. But when I learned where it came from, I really started to rethink my approach to using peat in any sort of garden setting. Because this is where peat comes from. It's mined. It's a non-renewable resource, no matter what someone wants to tell you. It comes from peat bogs. Bogs up in Canada, in Europe, Northern Europe. These peat lands only cover 3% of our world's land surface, but they store twice as much carbon as all of our forests. That's really important to protect those places. And then the unique thing about peat is it's undecomposed plant material, and that's where all that carbon storage comes from. It's not breaking down, turning back into gases, and going back into our atmosphere. So the more we're using peat, the more really sensitive, really amazing places with high rates of endemism are turning into these wastelands. And so I'm thinking about alternatives. You know, I've been experimenting, friends have been experimenting, I do a lot of reading. You know, compost is a really good place, and you don't even have to make your own. Not everyone's situated to have a big compost heap, especially if you're renting like I am. But there's a lot of really cool peat-free blends out there. These compost blends are really great. You can get different kinds of mixes, different types of materials added to them. And if you're like me, building soil for potted plants and stuff like that is really exciting anyway, so it can be a nice addition to what's going on. Also, coco coir. It's not the best. It's a waste product, though. It's made out of coconut husks. It's ground up into these little bricks that you put in water, and it's really fun to watch them expand and take up a ton of water. And then it's this really light, fluffy material that's inert like peat is. It's kind of pH neutral. You sometimes have to wash it, but otherwise, it's an amazing additive to soil mixtures if you really want to go that extra mile, and it holds moisture like crazy. So in thinking about not only just composting and trying to get rid of peat and amending your soils, when I say amend as little as possible, it's think about the challenges, but also rising to the challenges of working with the landscape that you have, that you've been lucky enough to stumble across, and try to think of ways that you can learn to select plants that do better for those conditions instead of saying, well, I have a lot of clay and there's a ton of water, I really like drought plants or desert landscaping. That's cool, and it's a theme throughout gardening. I think I've said this multiple times since I arrived here. We all want to grow plants that aren't good for our climate. It's just like the rule of thumb here is we get really excited about things we can grow ourselves. But I also think it's really interesting to challenge yourself to go that a little bit further, think about the conditions you have and try to find plants that meet those. And in thinking about coming out here, I was really nervous because I don't know California's plants and I don't know what's going on out here for the most part. I don't garden in this climate. So I headed over to Twitter and I said, hey, plant Twitter, tell me what you would love to see people gardening with more in Southern California and why. And this is the one that kind of came up repeatedly. Everyone complained about clay soils and what they have to face with heavy clay. And when it's dry, that's fine. You can do a lot of Xeric stuff. But when you have the rains that you've recently gotten, that situation changes pretty quick. And this one came up time and time again. This hummingbird sage is apparently really, really good at dealing with clay. It's beautiful. And check out that little hummingbird, right? Who doesn't want a hummingbird running around their garden? Come on. So here's a plant that enjoys sun, it enjoys shade. You can reproduce it vegetatively, which means you can start with one and end up with multiple. You can give them out as gifts if you're a cheap, poor person like me and you just love to give people beautiful things. Well, propagate some of your plants and give them to them. It can handle clay soils. That's pretty great. I deal with a lot of clay where I'm from because they built my town on top of a swamp. Which is a totally other issue entirely, but it is a challenge, but it's one that's been really entertaining because I've learned a lot more about plants that live on floodplains that are really beautiful. It's introducing me to a whole different set of the flora that I had no introduction to before, and that's really cool. And of course, as I said, attracting hummingbirds. What's great about that? I mean, there's so many cool things about all the wildlife viewing opportunities when you have a garden. Be able to see what kind of organisms are coming in and around and hanging out. It's amazing to see how our little, you know, quarter acre of lawn has now transformed itself into this amazing little hub of butterflies and ants and all these cool little insects. I mean, I'm into that sort of stuff, but there's many different opportunities out there. So also temperature. This is like the most pleasant temperature I've experienced in months, so I can't speak too much about that. I'm really enjoying it out here, but I know it gets hot, I know it gets dry. So instead of planting those water hogs, I mean, I was driving today and heard the whole thing on the radio about planting water-saving plants. It's really cool to hear that even being talked about on the radio. That's really exciting to me to have the kind of culture where that's acceptable and people are investing in that sort of stuff. But even thinking about that, you know, who wants to spend all that extra money on water when you could be drinking it and using it for your own needs versus trying to irrigate a bunch of stuff? So think about the types of plants you're bringing into your landscape. I don't want to go too into the weeds on biology here, but photosynthesis. Think about CAM and C4 plants, those succulent acid metabolisms that all the sedums and stuff are doing, or the C4 plants like these grasses, or you know this ocotillo here that I took picture of the snar discipline. It's like kind of makes it into the state, right? But again, focus on plants that can handle these conditions, and suddenly you're up against a lot less hurdles than you would be otherwise. I like working in the garden, but I don't like struggling in the garden. And so I know this is kind of, again, in the weeds, thinking about, oh, is this plant CAM or C4? And I don't want to bore you too much with this, but these are water-saving mechanisms. These are plants that evolved to deal with drought. And what's amazing is that there's two different ways you can do this. You can store it and use it at night, and then close up everything during the day and never waste any water, or you can just be really efficient and store it as an acid, and also be able to close during the hottest point of the day. But there's a lot of really beautiful plants out there, and I know Carol was telling me that seeing the hills green from this point on is kind of a rare event, and sometimes it's probably nice to have a little splash of green on your landscape when everything else is brown and brittle. And here's another one of those great recommendations, the salt brushes, the atriplex, and I think they get widely overlooked by a lot of people just because of these weird-looking shrubs. But up close and personal, they're beautiful. They've got these kind of crystalline structures on their leaves. They're really good at dealing with saline conditions, which is great if you live in an area that struggles with saline soils. And it's a C4 plant, which makes it drought resistant. It's evergreen, so it's keeping green on your landscape year round. And it's an important host for butterflies and moths, so it's got all of this great wildlife value. But even beyond all of the nerdy ecology stuff, how cool is that texture? I mean, look at those linear leaves with these strange little projections on their seeds, the winged seeds at the tips. These are the kind of plants that you get to meet when you're up against a challenge. You just think about it from more of an ecological context, and suddenly you're opening the door to a whole new slew of plant species out there. And even if you don't get them in a nursery, go hiking, see what's out, see what's looking good this time of year or later in the season, and maybe try to find seeds, get people growing these plants. Because if we make better decisions on that, our ecosystems are healthier, our gardens look better, and we're using a lot less water in the process, which I think we can all say, you know, cutting back on water is a good thing if you're living in a state that struggles with water issues. I'm not going to pretend that I don't water my garden. It's probably one of my biggest single uses of water besides showering every day, but cutting back on water is good. I'm not saying don't water your gardens. Obviously, irrigation is important, and you want your gardens to look nice, but by choosing more drought-tolerant species, especially the native ones, conditions can be a little bit more favorable and you're not spending as much time watering. You can spend more time enjoying, pruning, interacting with your plants. And so cutting back on water also means choosing a lot of really cool plants. I was just at the gardens today up at, remind me of the name?
Huntington.
The Huntington, yes, thank you. I was going to call it the Hilton, that's a hotel. So I was just at the Huntington and they have all these amazing barrel cacti. And can you think of any plant that represents drought tolerance better than cacti? And you don't even have to pick the native ones. There's tons of really cool cacti native to the Americas. I was blown away by the diversity of cacti in South America. Wow. So, like, otherworldly down there. But here's the cake cactus. It's a feral cactus, which I love that genus because it literally translates to ferocious cactus. Think about how well defended that little beast is. And it's a succulent. It's an obvious choice for drought resistance. It's extremely drought-hardy. But what's even cooler about farrow cactus, and a lot of other cacti I'm starting to find out, is that they have really specific mutualisms with ants. So here we see ants as bodyguards again. And you may look at a plant like this and go, why the heck would a cactus need a bodyguard? Well, it's really good with spines to keep the rabbits and the javelina from gnawing on you, but if you're a little caterpillar or a microbe that likes to chew on cactus flesh, you can slip right through those spines, no problem. And what's cool about ants is they are not only vicious at protecting food sources, they're also fastidious little buggers. They're very clean. They secrete antimicrobial compounds because they live in such high densities. They have to stay clean. And so what's cool is these cacti actually produce specialized spines that secrete nectar that the ants feed on, just like we saw with that caterpillar. The ants have an investment in the food source, so they're protecting it from herbivores. They're also worming all over, getting that antimicrobial action going on. They're cleaning the cacti of microbes, potentially harmful microbial life. And even beyond that, ants go back and live in colonies. They live in these hyper-dense colonies underground, and even what you think of as a small ant mound. I've got friends that study ants. They study ant casts. They actually take casts of these underground chambers. They're huge. The smallest ant colony is feet underground. It is remarkable. But that's not only aerating the soil, it's allowing infiltration for water, but they have all of these middens where they throw out their trash. And it's been shown that ant colonies in and around your garden can actually improve your soil nutrients. And so what's really cool is, if you don't want to mend your soil, here's a whole group of organisms doing it for free and protecting your plants at the same time. Pretty cool. And of course, they feed wildlife. I mean, these flowers are full of pollen and nectar, and the fruits are delicious. So, another one I got to meet today was this one, the giant coreopsis. How many of you have seen this or are growing it? Awesome. I love this plant. It was another one of those, this person on Twitter wouldn't shut up about it for like three threads. And I was like, okay, cool, I'll look into it. And it ended up being one of the coolest things I've ever seen. I mean, a coreopsis to me is this like little herbaceous daisy sitting in the prairie. But here's one that looks like something out of a Dr. Seuss novel. So oddballs, you don't even have to go with the traditional choices. This is where the getting creative part works. You know, this is one that has a nice succulent stem. It stores water in that stem. It's got these feathery leaves, which create a lot of surface area, but reduce the amount that's exposed to sunlight, so it stays green for longer. It does really well in high temperatures. So it's extremely drought hardy, although I've heard you have to irrigate it a little bit more than you would, especially when it's starting to get established. You know, I'm not saying don't water your garden. But you can't complain with that floral display. That is remarkable. And just seeing it today in person really set that in motion. I was like, wow, okay, giant coreopsis is one of the coolest things I've ever seen. And so, like I said, get creative. We love getting to know new plants, right? Who doesn't like to get introduced to something new? And I really like this botanist commission. I'm really into weeds. That's the only thing my mom ever says is like, why is your garden full of weeds? They're not. They're really cool plants if you give them a chance, or come back when they're blooming. You'll understand, I promise. And that's really fun to me, is to try and take that mentality and flip it on its head. And I've kind of got my mom actually on my side now. She doesn't like snakes, she doesn't like bees, but she's allowing more quote-unquote weeds into her garden because you can see the beauty of these things even when you isolate them and put them in a garden on display. And to me, it's just so much fun to seek out information on all great plants that are suitable for your conditions. I mean, it's not a matter of picking only native plants, although it's beneficial for you to do that, but think about the challenges that you're faced with and rise to them instead of trying to fight them constantly, because the less you're fighting the land, the better you're doing for the land. Which brings me to my second point, is this idea of gardening for resilience. Because no matter what, if we stopped everything we were doing today, if humans all just disappeared overnight, this planet is still going to be warming for thousands of years to come. We have irreparably changed things for a long time. We're going to be forging ahead into a very uncertain future, and our decisions can be made to bolster resilience in the face of that. We have to rise to this challenge, because it's not something that's affecting just a few places here and there. I recently talked to a professor that studies plants in the most remote corner of the Amazon. I mean, places where not even indigenous tribes go. They have to be airlifted into these spots. And even in these remote corners where human activity is essentially zilch, they're already seeing signs of climate change, changing plant distributions. They're moving farther up the mountains. New species are now coming into contact with species from higher elevation and changing the competitive dynamics. They're driving species to extinction that we don't even know exist yet. So this is happening. It's happening everywhere, and it's going to continue happening no matter what we do. But we can rise to meet this challenge based on what we do in the garden. Because plants really are this litmus test for climate change. And just the example I talked about in the Andes isn't isolated. These four species were studied in the Alps. These are alpine plants, and the study they did with these guys actually showed they're fine with the temperatures. They can handle the warming, no problem. They're actually probably grow better, faster, get bigger. But what they can't handle is all those new species that are moving up the mountain, all those species from lower elevations. Many of them are invasive, but many of them are not. And if you think about the tight-knit community that these evolved in, throwing new players into that system gets really scary. So those competitive dynamics start to change. So we have novel competitors. We have range shifts. These six species recently broke the world record for plants being found growing at the highest elevation. I think they found these at 22,000 feet of elevation in the Himalayas. And there's probably many, many more, but as you can imagine, getting up that high is a challenge, and most grants don't want to cover mountain climbing. But range shifts, this is something that's happening, we're seeing it. Changes in growth, this is the Arctic willow. There's a paper that just came out that was showing that not only are the growing seasons getting longer, plants are getting bigger, they're growing taller, and that's changing the way carbon cycles and the soil cycles throughout that ecosystem. So this is scary in a lot of ways, but it's showing that plants are already responding. And one of the hopeful things that I've really kind of taken away from my own research and something I work on day in and day out is this idea that plants are really plastic organisms. Because they can't get up and run, because they have to face whatever comes at them, oftentimes for many decades, if not centuries, and some plants will outlive all of us, they have to be plastic. They have to be able to adapt to changing things, because even without what we're doing to the climate, 50 years is a lot of time to think that things are going to stay the same, and times are always been changing. And here's a really good example from where I work. I work in southern Appalachia. I study climate change on endemic species in southern Appalachia, North Carolina, and South Carolina. And this one's beetleweed. It's a member of the carpetweed family, Diaconciaceae. But you know, here's that species growing in an incredibly rich, moist, shaded cove forest in southern Appalachia, the most humid place, the most nutrient-rich place I can think of in this continent. And there's the same species on the right there, growing at 5,000 feet of elevation in pretty much just lichen crust in full sun. So here's the same species dealing with pretty much the exact opposite conditions that we'd expect. So there's resiliency in there. We just have to protect it as much of it as we possibly can. So this plasticity is really starting to come online as what people think might actually be an advantageous thing to take advantage of, or at least to study a little bit more, to really understand how these plants might respond. Because for all we know, many of them could make it through, provided we give them a little bit of assistance. And in thinking about gardening for resilience, we really have to think about this in the terms of habitat fragmentation and destruction, because you don't have to wipe out every last member of a species to doom it to extinction. All you have to do is pretty much make life impossible for it going on into the future. And we're doing that really well by just chopping up their habitat, removing big chunks of it, and removing a lot of that connectivity. And here's a picture from Borneo. We all know what's going on with palm oil over there. But that's a faraway jungle and a place that many of us have no impact on and can't really do much about. But that's not to say that habitat destruction isn't happening here. And that's a big message that I think a lot of people, not anyone here, but a lot of people in the general public miss, is that this is going on in our own backyards. I mean, there's an aerial view of the city we're in right now, right? That was once native California landscape. I'm not against development. We all live, I live in a house, I drive on roads, right? But look about what's going on with the human population, especially on this continent. 82% of the US population is living in urban areas. And within 10 years, from 2000 to 2010, that increased 15%, and it's expected to triple by 2050. So these urban, suburban areas, especially our gardens, are actually really underrated centers of botanical diversity, because we get to choose what goes in them, right? Look at this. I mean, this is incredible that all this diversity is just here because this is stuff we have in our gardens. So we really have to rise to this challenge, and we're really uniquely positioned to deal with it, because if we waited on the federal government to do something, or if we waited for, or you know, asked botanical gardens to do it, they can't do it all. And so by choosing better things on our landscape, we can actually help this idea for resilience, because it's all about connectivity. And here's a really good example of, you know, these bats fly out when these cacti are opening their flowers, they drink the nectar, it's got proteins that help them develop, their babies develop, and then on the way back, from the migratory route, the fruits are primed and ready for them to disperse. But if they have to fly greater and greater distances it gets harder and harder and harder for that to be maintained. And this is really what I think about in terms of connectivity. What this guy is doing on the left with lawns is pretty much the antithesis of what all these little critters need to be happy. And this is first a concept in my head that was born out of something I used to do as a kid called the white tiles are hot lava, right? You ever play that game where you pick a color tile, you don't step on a crack, you have to jump and through, and you gotta find a pathway to get to that other door. And that's kind of how nature works, right? Connectivity is, imagine an organism that needs to go from that green area to that green area, and it can't go very far. Do you think the suburban-urban interface there is very welcoming? Well, imagine if a couple people started to put more gardens in, added a few more native plants, a few more added them. Suddenly there's some stepping stones that you can kind of see, that connectivity. And really in the center there is this idea of the municipalities encouraging corporations and new developments going in, trying to encourage them to do better landscaping than just to put in some London plane trees in an area that's going to experience drought 8 months out of the year. And the more I talk to landscape people, the more I'm starting to appreciate that encouraging corporations and these large campuses and stuff to do more sustainable landscaping actually makes more plants available to the public. It encourages mass plantings, and when there's mass plantings, it means there's mass production of plants. So think about it from that context, and suddenly, okay, we've got some more municipalities, and a few people saw what their neighbors were doing and decided maybe a lawn isn't for me, or I can get rid of a little more on my lawn. And, you know, this might be kind of kumbaya and hopeful, but I'd like to think that we live by example, and who hasn't looked at a garden or someone else's landscape and said, oh, I want that, you know? And that happens time and time again, so every one of us in gardening and in sharing that with people and showing that landscaping doesn't have to be this super elaborate or super expensive thing, it can just be a nice little patch where there used to be a lawn, can hopefully, maybe, encourage other people to get on board. So, my take-home message for gardening for resilience is something I've co-opted from Michael Pollan himself. Instead of eat food, mostly plants, My thing, my mantra for this is plants, mostly native, but hey, have fun, right? A pollination ecologist in my department once told me, you know, I used to be a purist, it was like, all natives only, and I agree, I wish it would mostly turn that way, but I also really enjoy a lot of other plants too. I enjoy biodiversity, and I like sharing my habitat with other plants from around the world. And so, if you plant a plant, and it flowers, and it doesn't take over, congratulations. No matter where it's from, you've increased biodiversity and the resources available. It's when you plant something and it takes over, suddenly you've done damage. But have fun. And that leads me to my last point. Share the wealth. You know, plants, no matter what we do, no matter how much we scream for the foreseeable future, they're not going to get the same protection as animals, and that makes me sad face. But again, that's not to lose hope. Just because the federal government doesn't want to step up and start protecting plants doesn't mean we can't do something about that. And gardeners are already amazingly keeping many species alive in captivity that would otherwise be completely extinct. So if you've ever been to Hawaii, this is one of the poster children for extinction, it's the olulu. To the best of my knowledge, there's maybe one or two plants left in the wild, growing on a cliff on a big island, or Kauai. Either way, very few left in the wild, but go to any garden center that kind of has someone that knows what they're doing when they order plants, and you will find one of these in there. They're everywhere. They're in every botanical garden. They're in a lot of plant collectors' collections. They're extremely easy to grow. It's just that their native pollinator has gone extinct. So if it wasn't for gardeners and houseplant enthusiasts growing this plant on their balconies and their landscape, this would be gone from the wild forever. But it may not be in the wild, it's not extinct. And that's pretty cool. I actually just saw this today, Deppia splendens. It's the first time I've seen it. It's not actually a fuchsia, it's a member of the coffee family. But this was found on one mountaintop in Mexico, a cloud forest. And when the person found it, he collected seeds, took a few cuttings, brought them back, disseminated them. A lot of botanical gardens got them, and they grew them. And it's beautiful, and it's an amazing plant. Well, he went back to make further collections and explore this cloud forest. And when he got back there, the entire mountaintop had been burned to the ground and was now a cattle ranch. And with it went every species that was in that forest. And to date, this has never been found growing anywhere else. But it's still alive. It's not extinct completely. It's extinct in the wild. But at least there's vestiges of it being kept alive in very specific collections, botanical gardens around the world, and that's really important because if we ever want to put the pieces back together, we at least have some of them. This one actually surprised the heck out of me. I had no idea because I see these literally everywhere, the angel's trumpet, Brugmansia. Not a single But if you ever go, have a chance to go walk through Panama and backpack through Panama, or these are in every farm, every roadside. And again, it's following humans around. It's only, all of these species are only on this planet because humans have kept them alive. And then finally, one we tend to overlook is the ginkgo. This was only ever known from fossils up until its discovery on a tiny little mountaintop in China. And when they went to that, it was a grove that had been maintained by monks for centuries. And to date, we do not know if there's a single wild population of these trees around, but saw plenty of them today. There's a bunch driving around on the streets. This has followed people around the globe, and it's not extinct. And it's a representative of a lineage that was once super diverse and now only has one member. So that's even cooler, right? It's like a harkening back. And so this is where gardeners come in, right? You don't need permits to grow these plants. You just decide to put them on your landscape, or you just know someone that has them that wants to be kind and share the wealth with you and put them in your landscape, and hopefully you will do the same. Because we have the time, we love the effort, and most of us have the space, at least some of us have the space. And to expect botanical gardens to pick up the slack, I love botanical gardens, I'm not downplaying their role in conservation at all. We desperately need more of them, we need to fund them better, we need way more people working on conservation there, but you know, here's three great examples of three species of photocarps from New Caledonia. They're wetland plants. They grow on these stream sides in this tiny little island that's being ripped apart by nickel mining. And in the next 10 to 15 years, there probably won't be any of these left. But they're a giant tree. They can only keep so many of these underneath a glass house in temperate North America. So we can't expect botanical gardens to do it all. They do a lot. Like I said, we need to support the heck out of them. We really encourage them to do more science and conservation work. But they can't do it all. I mean, here's three great examples from the Atlanta Botanical Garden. But you can only plant so many pitcher plants or ghost orchids. So the fact of the matter is, because plants don't get the same protection as animals, it means we actually have the opportunity to do something about it. And that's one thing I learned, is that when you want to get permission to work with an endangered plant species, most people don't care, they just can't. But if we do that ethically, if we do that for good reason, things can change. And the best part about gardening, and the thing I love about the gardening community, is that gardeners get to know plants better than pretty much everyone else. I work in a department of plant ecologists. I bet maybe three of them can identify native plants or even be able to grow anything. I mean, they just don't, and it's tragic, and I don't get it, I don't like it. But every one of you can, and this is a species actually I work with. This is one of my main focal species. It's Candeias, Shortia glacifolia. It's related to that beetle weed you saw earlier. And this is endemic to a very small portion of the southern Blue Ridge Mountains, and most of its population was flooded to death by the building of two reservoirs. And luckily enough, people went in right before those reservoirs went in and literally rolled these plants up like turf and brought them back, disseminated them to botanical gardens, and now it's something that people can buy at native plant sales or can go to a botanical garden and see. It grows well outside of the range in which it was found in the wild. But the weird part is like we tend to fetishize rare plants. People know more about endangered species than they do common species because we like the rare stuff. We want to do something for the rare stuff, and to do something for it, you have to understand it. Well, not the case for this one. Barely anything's known about this plant, at least in the literature. And that's really annoying from a scientific perspective when you're trying to appease your committee and they're going, where's all the information? It's not there. But the cool thing is I go and work in southern Appalachia, and inevitably people are really curious why I'm hunched over with my hands and some ground cover in the middle of the woods. So they stop and they talk to me. And just talking to local gardeners, I have learned more about the biology of the species than any scientist has ever been able to tell me. And that's really special. You really need to pat yourselves in the back for all of the knowledge contained in this room. It is amazing, and don't ever downplay that. You don't know what's important until it's important, right? For instance, no one knows how this species disperses its seed, or at least science doesn't know how the species disperses its seed. But the people that grow it realize that after it's fertilized, the ovule reaches up to the sky, it opens up and digests, and it creates this perfect little cup that when rain falls on it, splashes them out into the environment. I would never have known that unless it was for someone who had gardened with the species for 25 years. And I'm indebted to this man forever, and he's just a gardener. I don't know what he does for a living, he just gardens. And it's incredible. So now I have better knowledge of why the species doesn't expand beyond where it currently exists. And that might remove it. And then just learning how to grow plants. I mean, how many of you grow something that other people have said, oh, I just killed that, right? It happens all the time. I kill things that people can keep alive and vice versa. And people have so much knowledge on how to grow these things that we need to get that out there. And you wouldn't believe how many people you talk to that work for like the Millennium Seed Bank or all these places where we're safeguarding seeds, that genetic diversity, but have no idea what to do with them. It's one thing to save the seeds, it's another thing to actually get them to germinate and grow. So anything you learn, anytime you're germinating a seed or succeeding with a plant where others have failed, write it down, tell someone, get it out there, because you never know when that's going to come in handy. It's amazing. Learning how to germinate a seed and grow a plant, I think, is one of the most fundamentally important things that humanity has ever stumbled across. And if you're keeping that knowledge to yourself, shame on you. And you can also serve as a really great early warning system for potential invasive species. Here's four that are invasive here and in many other states. All were brought in by horticulture. I don't want to demonize horticulture. I love experimenting with different plants. But because we have intimate knowledge on growing them and interacting with them, we understand when they start to get a little bit out of hand. So warn people. Say, hey, this one tends to show up in places I don't want it to, or it's starting to crowd this out. It's just good information. No one's saying, stop that, don't do that, unless they finally say this one's illegal to sell. But at least you can be there to say something about it, to tell people that maybe this one isn't the best choice if you live in this area. And then finally, sharing your plants and seeds. I'm not saying just give them away, although you know having a raffle is a really cool way of doing that. But so many plants aren't being cultivated to a great degree. Sometimes they're pretty esoteric and weird. I have a very strange succulent collection at home that not many people even recognize as such. But as soon as they get big enough, I have to divide them, I have to give them to people, because not only does that help me, if I inevitably kill it, I can say, hey, remember when I gave you that? I need it back now. But it also safeguards the species, but it also gets more of it out there. Sharing your plants, aka selling them for cheap, or just selling them in general, or just saving seeds and giving seeds away, means more plants in cultivation and less pressure on wild populations. Think about all those news reports about what's going on with Dudley's when people from Korea and stuff come over, because it's such a big thing over there. These succulents are such a big hobby. There's such a demand for them. They're coming out of our backyards instead of being propagated. So the more plants we get out, the more we share the wealth, the better off we can build for these native plant populations, for wild plants everywhere, and just for bringing that resilience more to the forefront of our gardening endeavors. So with that, I'll take your questions. I'm all on these social media accounts, and I also have apparel for sale as well, not here, on the internet, and everything you purchase, a portion of that goes to the Rainforest Trust, because as much as I like to do stuff in my own backyard, I can do a little bit with the wallet overseas as well. So with that, I'll take your questions. Thank you so much for listening.
I'm on the thing about
It's a great thing to be fired up about. I respect it.
I've been thinking about this for like 2 years. And it drives me crazy. I walk into a store and pick it up and say, oh, pound cake. And you can go to the bakery, you can go to the shake. Oh. When you go to Trader Joe's, you can get, not Trader Joe's, I'm sorry. Go to 99 cent store. You can get palm oil free pound cake. There's no palm oil.
Good to know.
And it costs 99 cents.
Even better. Now you're speaking my language now.
The point
Poor
is you have to read and look.
Yes.
And for God's sake, don't buy Roundup or
Well, I'd like to say we're doing really well, but our state's like 98% corn and soybeans, so it's what's amazing to me and something I really get fired up about living in Illinois, because I was like, I don't want to move to Illinois. It seems like the places that have been hit the hardest and destroyed the most seem to really cultivate the strongest native plant communities I've encountered. I mean, there are 4 native plant sales in my city. City is a very liberal word for where I live, but this is a town of, you know, maybe 100,000 people, Champaign, Urbana, and they have 4 native plant sales in spring alone. And there's native plant ice, there's prairie restoration, they're growing all of these local ecotypes, so they go collect seeds from remnant prairies and use them for restoration. It's really inspiring until you drive out and see what we're up against, but I'd rather see that happen than nothing at all. So I think they're doing a really good job. But I mean, just the fact that we're here talking about this tells me it's something that's coming into the lexicon a lot more each and every year. So,
do you feel like the increasing amount of science that's going on is going to have any impact on like policy decisions? I mean.
So she asked if the increasing amount of science and the emphasis on science is going to affect policy. I hope. I will say I've never seen my cohorts more fired up about political situations. I will say that I've never seen more of my friends actually getting involved and doing politics, trying to get involved themselves. I'd like to hope. I don't know. We'll see.
All right.
Thank you again. I really appreciate it.
Well, thank you for that wonderful talk. And thanks for showering every day. That's really good. And just for an opposing viewpoint, I would like to point out my farming community. There's a huge facility, a company called Seminis, which is now owned by Monsanto, but there is an entire campus of wonderful people breeding no GMO plants, all kinds of great tomatoes and spinach and lettuce, and they have been for 40 years. But now, because of the anti-Monsanto thing, they had to put barbed wire around the parking lot because people get their cars vandalized, and they're just plant geeks like you and me. They just happen to work for a company somewhere else. So remember, Monsanto sells GMO seeds, we know that, of about 7 kinds of plants, soybean, corn, a few others. And they actually have over 10,000 different kinds of plants that they produce seeds for. So there's good with bad. And thank you for that gardening for resilience and that statistic on urban living. It's a great segue for these plants here. And for my own approach, those of you who saw the Pat Court article about me a year or two ago, they came up with the term breeding or finding urban plant warriors, I think is what they said. And that's what I do. And my friend Jim Berry in Grand Saline, Texas, which is kind of a little ways east of Dallas and on the way to doesn't fall for pretty faces and novelties. Everything he does is about creating more resilient, tougher plants. He's worked for other different plant breeding companies, struck out on his own when his son was old enough to start a nursery with him, and he's really become a player in the world of horticulture. And most of you know that we have the sort of New York Fashion Week or Paris Fashion Week for horticulture, but for professional horticulture, and it's in California, and it's the last week of March, first week of April. And the breeders from all over the world come to California and put on displays of their new plants. And everybody is breeding for resilience. They know they have to come up with plants that will work in urban environments because that's where we're all going to be living, almost. I'll be living on a farm with my resilient plants. So I'm going to tell you about a few of Jim's plants here.